manifest the character of Colin. He never complained, he never told anything. Okay.
It also can create your heart.
Thank you. Did we have any problem with you on the subject?
Of course. But different.
We shall wait for another moment.
Don't say so. Okay. The important paper made by Kohler is related to the so-called Venus ring. It's double core vortex, and its dynamics, dissipation are determined also by the friction forces, which were discussed by Kohler. It depends on the relaxation occurs due to the fermion zero watts acting on the vortices. So it's just due to the jump between different levels in the water score. So it's not a little bit of that. Okay. One paper, which is also fundamental, is related to so-called Kibble-Zurich scenario, which is absolutely different from Kibble-Zurich. It is a creation of vortices due to the propagating front of the normal superfluid transition. If the front is moving, then if it's moving very slowly, then the water parameter becomes the square root of minus x. But if
what is x?
X is a position from x is a
position of the front propagation.
Yeah? Position of the front propagation. Mm-hmm. But if the velocity is large enough, then there is a lag of the water parameter, because the parameter doesn't have time to relax, and there is a region where the water parameter is zero, but the temperature is essentially smaller than transition temperature, and in this region the vortices start to be created. So this was an absolutely new mechanism, so we can call this Kapin-Tonneberg mechanism. So this is a region of supercooled and normal Q1 stream. Okay. This is the famous paper by Kapin Salama, which is now cited by many people who knows about the origin of the Majorana-Herkman, because the state with zero energy, exactly zero energy, is Majorana-Herkman there, was first published in this paper. This is the energy of the spectrum of the fermion of the vortex core. Pz is the linear momentum of the vortex, and Q is the angular momentum of the vortex. So there are different branches, and one of them is just called the flat band. So it has exactly zero energy, yes, but it consists of Majorana fermions, and the energy is zero for the whole region inside momentum, inside fermion momentum. Okay, and this actually gave rise to the new area in physics which is related to the topological flat bands, and there is a flat band which occurs on the surface of the semi-metals, must occur on the surface of the semi-metal, and this is actually the topic of Derek Hickler, but he was ill and the doctor did not recommend him to come here. I will say just a few words which Derek sent me. So my work is Nikolai Kapnin. So he was sharing offices now for several years. For 4 years they were together in one room. They had the common project of molecular superconductivity starting in 2006, and they start the flatband superconductivity with hope to obtain the Rockland superconductivity. And many times asking for his advice on physics, chemical matters, different aspects of superconductivity, carrier matters, and so on. And he got the needed response. So he wrote that Nikolai is well known as a kind of friendly person, a thorough physicist, I wish to share one additional thing I would like to learn from him. Nikolai really knew the value of time. First, he never seemed to be too busy to discuss physics or other things. Second, when needed, he was able to use whatever time was required to finish a detailed calculation. Yes, that's really important. The detailed calculation made by him was perfect. Nikolai's attitude seems to have been choose what you want to do and then do it. He didn't spend his time with, for him, useless things. I'm honored and pleased to have had the possibility to work with such a great scientist and great man. Derek Hickler. Okay, if you don't have any questions, then I will start our... I will give the talk, or at least my version of the talk related with the same title, with Derek Hickler, who was at the Alta University when he was working with Kapina, now he's in the US. Okay, so please, questions, and then I can start.
Maybe one, maybe a naive question. Schubert is this slide is the sum of three forces.
Yes.
No, you did that before.
Before?
No. Where's next one? Next one? That is one. So, you see, you have the first term is product of XL. Okay, this is a polar vector. But the second is XL vector, seems to me. No, no. Second one. This one.
No, it was the second sentence.
The third. The second term.
The second term is yes.
Three times.
Yes, it is along the. It is just perpendicular. It is along the vortex motion. So this is vortex, and if one is moving.
N is XL vector or polar vector.
N is a vector along the vortex axis.
Polar vector.
Yes.
And three times vector polar product. So you will have XL vector. And the first is polar vector. How is it possible?
First of all, so the axis of the vortex is a polar vector. It's an axial vector because when time passes.
N is axial
vector. Yes.
Oh, that's not okay.
Yes, because when you change time minus time, the ending number circulation goes to zero. So it's a direction of circulation.
So everything's okay?
Yeah, sure. Okay. So, why flat plane superconductivity is just normal type of superconductivity? Probably nobody has seen still that, but there are some experiments which indicate that probably this is the case. But still, practically, nobody believes to sustain. Okay. Anyway, let's start with just this conventional Fermi surface and proconventional Fermi surface. And Fermi surface actually is not conventional. Fermi surface is topologically stable. So why actually we have all the why we have the metals is practically all where all the properties are similar. So because we have Fermi surface. And but Fermi surface can be destroyed by interaction. In principle, nobody says there are some special reasons for survival of the Fermi surface of interaction. But there is. The reason is topology. And just due to topology, we have Fermi surface. And because of the Fermi surface, we have superconductivity. Because if there is no Fermi surface, there is no superconductivity. So still, we don't have the materials where we have superconductivity, but we don't have Fermi surface. The reason for superconductivity is finite instance. So, but the reason for the Fermi surface is topology. So, why is that? So, all of the topological media they can be represented as a topological defect or topological object in momentum space, a space of momentum P. I will show the convergent Fermi surface is just vortex with volume number unity is appreciated by 2 pi. The elementary particles and wire similar metals, they are described by the Hitchcock. All the topological insulators, they correspond to the non-singular topological objects, they are called skirmions in momentum space. There are 2 examples of this flat band. One of the flat band was found in the interacting system by Hodel and Shigenian, which represents the half quantum vortex in momentum space, and another was found by Kaplan and Solomon, where the flat band looks like a Dirac string terminating on Dirac monopoles. Dirac monopoles is just H pop, which lives in the bulk, but this guy lives inside the vortex. Only about 10 years later, people found that a similar object exists at the Fermi arc on the surface of one semi-metal. So in this case, there is a Fermi, a one-dimensional Fermi surface living on the surface, and it terminates just on this threshold. So actually, the idea of the, as far as I know, came from the physics of Kaplan, Solomon, and inside the vortex. Okay, so there is a bulk H correspondence, so the topology in bulk it protects the topological object in, on the surface or inside the topological defect, inside the vortex core. So we know that, say, three-dimensional topological insulator has Gödel's Dirac fermions, which were found first by Wolfgang and Krause. But for us, it's important that even the material which are Gibbs, they have topologically protected states with zero energy of high dimension. For example, the semi-metal with Skirmina has two-dimensional flat band on the surface, and we discuss this. Equivalent point, just trying to construct room temperature superconductivity. And also, Higgins ray with this H-pop one point, it gives rise to one dimensional flat band. So, two important correspondence they are found by Coyle. Okay, so there are 2 major uncertainty classes. Gapless topological matter, one of them is the Fermi, the ground state which has Fermi surface. The Fermi surface is so all universal properties of metals and actually finally superconductors, they emerge from the topological stability of the Fermi surface. And topological stability of the Fermi surface comes from the fact that the Fermi surface represents the vortex in momentum space. How to see that? Let's start with non-interacting fermions. Mu is a chemical potential, EF corresponds to the Fermi momentum, and if the chemical potential is positive. And if P is smaller than PF, then all the state zero temperature are occupied, all the state outside are empty, and that's why we have some boundary. But that boundary, in principle, can be destroyed by interaction because interaction due to interaction, some particle from here move outside, and that's why, at first glance, there is no reason why the Fermi surface survives interaction. But it survives because if you look at the Green function, which is I omega minus energy, then we find that the Green function has singularity. This is 1 over G, and G is not determined by this 0 and this 0. So if we suppress some momentum, easy, for example, then we have three-dimensional frequency momentum space, and in this space, the Green function singularity will be equal to 0 and when P equal to PF. So this is the line, and when we go around this line, that the phase of the Green function changes by 2 pi. And this 2 pi cannot be destroyed by adiabatic switching of on the interaction. So whatever is the interaction, and if it's there, you switch it on adiabatically, because without superconductivity, the superconductivity changes a lot immediately, the stronger it changes the spectrum, this phase difference never disappears, and that's why there will be a final density state on this, close to this omega zero, and that's why one would have superconductivity at higher voltage. Okay, so there are examples, there is a jump. In conversion situations, there is a Mignot jump at the Fermi moment, but in principle, it can be marginal Fermi liquid, not even Fermi liquid, where the derivative of the have singularity, but there is no jump. But anyway, the singularity is still there, and finite density states are still in the direction. Okay. So it's very similar to what happened with the vortex ring, where the order parameter changes by 2 pi. Here it is the Green function changes by 2 pi. But in principle, the Green function can be matrix many by many, because it's bad CRE construction in metals, running in bands. And that's why it's class of mapping of contact to the space of the non definite complex matrices. Okay. But conventional Fermi liquid is described by a simple theory of Landau. So if Landau introduced the functional energy as a functional of distribution function of function of P, and variation of this functional must be zero, and it is zero when delta n is zero. Because n is unity below when it's occupied, and zero when it is non-occupied. So delta here is zero, delta here is also zero, so it's okay. But at the jump, delta n is not determined, but in this case, to satisfy this equation, epsilon should be zero. So we have the energy spectrum which crosses zero, crosses the point where the n is not. So this is the conventional Landau theory, but Hodulin-Shigenian, it's not written that Hodulin-Shigenian, but anyway, in this paper they found that when you increase interaction, there can be another solution of this equation. So the region where delta n is not determined is broadened. And inside the solution, epsilon equal to zero, epsilon equal to zero must be satisfied. So they obtain the length answer, epsilon. If we move this point due to interaction just to zero, then you will find that the whole solid sphere of the radius of P2 is occupied by the state with zero energy. So this is a Fermi ball instead of the Fermi surface. The same Fermi ball can be obtained by some particle physicists using some either the Sitter conformal field theory correspondence. So anyway, this confirms that the solution is not wrong. So this is a type of wet band, and it corresponds to half-bound waters, because the phase when you go around this flat band changes by pi. So there are two half-bound waters, so they terminate the dark solid from environmental space. Okay, this is a recent paper by Misha Kasserson and others, and they consider the two-dimensional system. Fermi condensation is what Hodulin-Shigenian it was in terminology, for the terminology of Hodulin-Shigenian fermi condensation. All the states are zero energy. So it's not Fermi condensation, but it's Fermi condensation. It's power principle, of course. But all the states with zero energy are occupied, but they are different. And they found that if the interaction is small, so the Hubbard parameter is zero, then this is just the one of singularity here. So it's not for one result, but the temperature is 0.1, so it's not zero temperature. But when the interaction becomes strong enough, they found that the pulses region has a zero energy. So they have put the flat band of order and Trigonian time. Then I looked at my paper in 94 and also found that this was obtained using not the exact theory of Hubbard model, but just Landau, using Landau theory, the same as Fodor-Schwerin. So we have the same situation, the closed is a certain point, then the flip band appears. So first it appears, you change the chemical potential, approach the single point, this thick line corresponds to the emergence of the flat band, this two flat band merge and form this guy, then you increase the chemical potential further, and they split, and then they appear.
Do you found this analytically?
No, in this Landau theory.
Ну, здесь космонавтика.
Космонавтика.
А просто мы немерили. Ну, вы сказали, что
Sorry, and about you, what is the Fermi condensate?
Fermi condensate is this one, and this one also. You see, this is the end of the Fermi condensate.
What is this? It is the region where the energy is identically
zero. The energy is zero. So you start from two Fermi surfaces, which are close to each other, and close to the Fermi point, and then at some moment you will find that this becomes thick. So it means that...
Misha?
Yes?
I would like to say that recently we found some signature of Fermi condensation in the dimensional electron system in quantized magnetic field, and it's published very recently.
Yes, yeah, I know. Yes, I also wanted to mention that, yes. So it means merging from the Landau levels. Yes. So it's some, what we were going to say, if you want, that, why do you say it? So due to speed up with interactions of Landau, some other interactions of Landau, Landau levels split. But when we introduce particle-particle interaction, of this Hubbard ball, at some moment you will find that they again merge, just forming two states with zero energy. So exactly the same as this one, but in different dimensions. Okay. So why is this important for superconductivity? First, why Fermi surface is important for superconductivity? So this is the equation for the superconducting transition. G is the coupling in Cooper pair. E is the energy, like that. Now, the integration is over all the momentum. Then if there is no Fermi surface, then this has no solution, unless G becomes some only some large G, you will find that there is a solution. But situation changed for the Fermi surface. For the Fermi surface, everything is concentrated close to Fermi momentum. Then this becomes logarithmically divergent. So it's logarithm of some ultraviolet cutoff divided by gap. From that, we obtain that the gap on transition temperature is proportional to exponent minus 1 divided by G. And the density of states of the Fermi surface. So G enters exponentially, but for any g, for any small g, the transition temperature exists, whatever is g. So it means that supergravity is natural for the system with the which has a Fermi surface, and Fermi surface emerges just due to topology. So topology produces actually the superconductivity, and also causes the Fermi magnetism, the finance instability, whatever. So all the energy increases come from the existence of the Fermi surface. That's why from topology. But now we have very different situation. Now this guy is zero. And if the guy is zero, here is simple delta. Okay. Then you move delta here, and one of the delta is 3 times integral of momentum space over the region where the flat band exists. So one of the transition temperature is proportional to coupling constant times the volume of the flat band. And you see there is no exponential suppression. That's why
it's a strange logic, because by definition, critical temperature should be found at zero delta. And here you have a finite delta already at critical temperature. How is it possible?
I give you the simplified version.
Oversimplified version.
Okay, but I don't. In this case, Euler should give a talk and everything. The temperature.
This should be substituted by delta. That's all.
This
addition is valid for zero temperature.
Yes, this is for zero temperature. But the dependence of delta zero temperature and transition temperature, of course, is different from conventional, I don't remember, 2.7, but this is different. This difference, of course, will be found, but it's also for Trochimity. It was calculated by the level. So this is for this is gap at zero temperature. And this gap at zero temperature is related with transition temperature. Just TC is proportional to some prefactor gap at zero temperature. Just in the same manner as this situation. There is no big difference except for numerical parameter. Okay, so and then let's go to the other topic, the topological flat bands. So the flat bands which I discussed before, the Kolmogorov-Schwarzenegger flat band, comes from the interaction. So the interaction creates the Fermi surface upon the flat band. But here the flat band appears just due to topology. So if there is a line, nodal line in momentum space, then on the surface of this material, there should be the flat band. And the boundary of this flat band is determined by the projection of this line to the surface. Actually, a similar situation was found in 2002, probably by Rui Hatzegaya, for conventional graphene. In graphene, there are nodes, and the projection of these nodes on the surface gives rise to the flat band. The topological invariant we describe this line and this flat band are exactly the same as for graphene. Also, long ago, Kashiwai and Tanaka, they found the flat band in Cuprate superconductors, where you have the gap nodes, but this is not interesting for us because this appears only in superconducting state. But we are interested in the situation when flat band appears in non-superconducting state, just to produce the superconductivity, to be the source of the superconductivity. And this is what found by Коля, Коля Солома, where the projection of the Hayes form on the vortex axis gives you the flat band of size vortex.
Sorry, in which order parameter?
During order parameter.
During.
It's conventional, it's conventional.
Okay, and another question about the left picture. What is the origin of this long line?
I will tell you. Okay, this is just a start of answering the question. That, let's consider to the graphene. This is the energy spectrum of graphene, and there is a, in momentum space, there are six points, but two of them will be non-equivalent, and each has the topological invariant, which is written on top of the sum. Integral over the around the point where H is the Hamiltonian, and there are some symmetry operator K, which is in given cases anti-commute with Hamiltonian, so this is a real topological environment. And it's plus one and minus one. Close to the plus one and minus one, there is actually some powerful mathematical theory, which is called anti-Shapiro construction, which says that if the topological environment is unity, then close to the close to this point, the spectrum becomes linear and reduced. This is for mathematicians. Okay. Now, what happens if you have two graphene layers, bilayer graphene? Then, if they are not interacting between each other, then each of them has this conical point, relativistic spectrum. C is the fairy velocity, not the speed of light. And each has a topological chair unit. So this integral equal to plus two together. Now you introduce interaction between them, and one finds that these two branches, they just after merging, they form the branch with the left, which that's why has a topological invariant zero, because there is no singularity in the green function, and zero, no zero in the Hamiltonian, but one obtains the non-relativistic Dirac spectrum. So Dirac spectrum with touching point, it is non-relativistic because it is quadratic, and it has topological charge plus two. So if you put the effective Hamiltonian, which looks like this. So, this is a linear Dirac in two dimensions, conventional relativistic Dirac, this is quadratic Dirac, and for this quadratic Dirac, the Hamiltonian has the topological charge equal to plus two. Then what happens if you have three Dirac fermions, then, three branches. So if they are not interacting, we have three branches with linear spectrum, but after the interaction is introduced, one finds that two branches become big, but one branch has PQ singularity with the spectrum energy equal to PQ and minus PQ. So it is, again, there are fermions, but they are non-relativistic with cubic spectrum, and the effective Hamiltonian for them is this one, and it gives you the topological charge equal to three.
Grish, you can obtain this result just introducing Hopping integral between the layers just for analytically?
Of course, but why? Why should I do that? Just from topology, I immediately say that it will be like that. Analytically, not analytically, numerically.
Analytically, for two layers you can do it.
For weak Hopping, why not?
Of course. You can provide any calculation, but how do you know that this is a universe?
Yeah.
You use a parameter, why do
you... Okay, but if you have graphite, for instance, not graphene, you should have flat band.
Not exactly, because I will tell you about that, because the problem is that the symmetry is still, some Hopping parameters are suppressed. They are small, but they
here.
But they violate the symmetry issues. Yes. So it in
how you suppress this copy, correct? So it's particular situation report, actually.
Particular situation experimental.
It's not topology, it's particular situation report.
No, no, no. It is a symmetry protected topology. So if you have some special symmetry, and the symmetry is well defined, and it is almost there, because the scoping parameter which violates it is small. You can, if you agree with this, you obtain the result. But it is the most fashionable thing in topological oscillator, symmetry protected topological order. And this is just the case. Okay, so this is a numerical simulation of what you suggested. So this is 3 layers, then 6 layers, 10 layers, 100 layers, 200 layers. One finds that finally, when the number of layers increase to infinity, but the symmetry is still preserved, one obtains the perfect band. In reality, the situation, of course, is more complicated because at very low energy, the situation doesn't look like that. For example, for bilayer graphene, it's not the fate of the final spectrum of bilayer graphene depends on the Hopi parameters. And at some Hopi parameters, which probably is the most relevant for the graphene, one has a following situation, that instead of this branch is only a charge equal to, one would have 4 conical spectrum with topological charges, +1, +1, +1, and -1. All together, they are also 2. So this is how it happens that at very low temperature. So this is a demonstration of how the formation of the topological charges works.
And what does it mean for graphite?
I will show the graphene too. So this actually is the same scenario as the graphene. But in this case, you see, the symmetry is already not needed because they are split, the topological charge already at different moment. That's why they effectively correspond to a single graphene layer. And that's why these nodes do persist. And even without any calculation, you can say that either you have this guy or you have something like that. So it's like summation law for topological defects. Without calculation, you can predict what happens. 1 plus 1 is 0, or 1 plus 1 is 2. So it is the same. Here, 1 plus 1 is 0. It is 2. Okay, this is how this was calculated with different Hopi parameter. And what is interesting is that when the number of layers increases, then some gapped state, this is for n equals 3, you see it is gapped, this is n equals 6 and 10, and then you will find that when n becomes infinite, there appears a node at some momentum p naught. And this is just the origin of this line in the bulk. So in the bulk, you have the line of zeros, it has a topological charge, and projection of that topological charge surface gives you the flat band, the boundary of the flat band. The reason for that is actually also topological. So let's consider this line, which starts at different ends of the brilliant zone in momental space. So we fix p(x) and q(y), so only pz changes. So there is no crossing of this line, that's why the energy is nowhere zero. It means that one has one-dimensional topological insulator. And insulator is topological because the integral over this line, of this guy is you. But we know that for topological insulators, there are H states with zero energy.
So but the radius of this flat area proportional to n?
No. It doesn't proportional to n. No, it is fixed by the parameters of the system, by the main topic parameter.
But anyway, it's n dependent.
No, it's at n goes to infinity.
Okay.
So it's already in the bulk. It's already three-dimensional situation. The line that appears, and due to this line, there is a flat point here. So for each point inside this region, for each line, there, for each topological insulator, one has the H state with zero energy. So you can support a bunch of the zero energy state inside this region. But the topological charge along this line is zero. Okay. So I have a few minutes. This is what happens in so-called rubber hydrographite, where instead of the line is due to the violation of this symmetry, this K-symmetry, which was important for the construction of the flat point, in the conventional graphite there is a system of the sausages with electron pockets, hole pockets, and so on, but they are still coupled to each other. You cannot separate them. There is still no, there is no topological invariant, but there is some remnants of this topological invariant. This includes some integral, which is not zero, which is not integer, but still not zero. And that's why these guys cannot be split. And the projection of them gives the approximate flat point. And this is conventional graphite, where also we have the sausage here, but the projection on the side surface will give you the flat point. Approximate flat point. This is what really happens in this graphite, where there is a splitting. Normally you ask what happens in graphite, this is just splitting and more different touching points. This is what Coyle calculated, that on the surface there could be superconductivity, and again, the equation is very similar to that equation. And the transition temperature is proportional to the area of the flat point, and the energy epsilon a little bit more complicated, but situation is very similar. Okay, so there are some evidence with question mark of ground temperature. Activity in the papers by Eskenazi and Kovosa. So what they found, some strange behavior of voltage as a function of temperature.
Inert material.
Sorry?
Inert material.
In graphite. So this is graphite. And what happens in this graphite is that there are interfaces between different domains. And this domains, they differ actually by twist. So there's some twist between this bulk states. And they found that all these effects come only from the interface between different domains. This interface is about a nanometer. So it was just a few layers of graphene. What can be the explanation of that? So you know that in graphene there are the flat band on the surface, but what happens on the in the interface? Interface contains interface when there is a twist between two different domains. It contains a lot of dislocations. It contains a network of dislocations. And we know that the dislocation is just some kind of extra, it's just example, the extra line of the graphene, and the extra line of the graphene has an H, and the H controls the flat band. So it's possible that this strange behavior that they have been observed just come from the physics of this photometry. So it's not related to the lead band in the Rama Ketchum profile, but it's related to the lead band which should occur inside the dislocation. Okay, so conclusion of lead bands that lead band actually becomes a generic phenomenon. One of them appears not exactly topological, it comes from the splitting of the ferment surface, but actually it's also related to topology because it describes the half-contour vortex in magnetic space. So they should occur near one whole singularity, because this is confirmed by phenomenology and also by numerical simulation. Then there was topological surface and edge-clad bands in graphene, graphite. Then there is Karpin-Salama-Maranovod, which is a flat band in the water square. Flat band may occur on its location in graphite. In topological oscillators, in artificial lattices, so it's known as an Akagami lattice, and in spin-wallen lattice, there appears a flat band, they are not topological, they appear symmetric. And they can be simulated in ultra-cold gases. And it opens parametrically different scenario for the one set of superconductivity. Because it's parametrically different, so it's not exponential, it's really proportional to the happening for the same thing.
Okay. Two short questions. Okay.
I have a question concerning this lead band superconductivity. Are there any peculiarities in the Meissner response? I'm asking because naively I would expect that because of the zero group velocity, the supercurrent cannot flow.
This is what actually Kapnin calculated. So the energy spectrum is not delta. It's delta multiplied by square root of 1 minus b squared, where p is momentum. And that's why there is the current, and he calculated current. And this is a special work of him, I think, it was published in. If he's a B, or if you are real, I don't remember. Mm-hmm. So he just did it.
But as far as I remember, Polish said that the Ginzburg-Levanov number quite big here.
Due
to fluctuations, this superconductivity not exist.
No, it's a factor about 2 or 3. So the decrease of temperature due to supplementation is only by this factor. This is what actually Terra Hekela and his student were calculated. So they calculated. He could not talk.
Levanov number?
Huh?
Levanov number?
Yes.
Okay, let us thank this again.